Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting. The first item on the agenda is the minutes of the previous meeting. Are there any changes or corrections that anyone would like to make?
None.
I just found mine to say. Only one change on page five. Maybe Mr. Emery will disagree with me, but I think in the last full paragraph there, I think it was Mr. Etzel that raised the issue on the rental pool.
No, I think I did. I don't recall.
I do. I think that's it.
Any other changes?
None.
Fair motion?
Move that they're accepted as amended.
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Opposed? Okay, moving along here. Correspondence with our package this evening, excuse me, includes a memo from Tom Leahy regarding right-to-know/conflict of interest. Memo from Michael McGovern regarding Dominica's Crossing. Letter from T.Y. Lynn regarding billing rate. Vernal Pools issue profile. Lincoln Institute land policy forum. Planning shopping center article October 95. Zoning news December 95. Zoning news January 96. Planning Commissioner's Journal, winter 1996. Letter from T. Robinson regarding Cantor Lane. Memo from Ernest McVane regarding Cantor Lane. Letter from S. Terrian regarding Dominica's Crossing. Memo from Michael McGovern regarding Dominica's Crossing. Town Manager meeting notes regarding Dominica's Crossing. Letter from Ernest McVane regarding Dominica's Crossing, and memo from Ernest McVane, another one, regarding Dominica's Crossing. And also on the podium tonight, there were three items. letter from Jack Roberts, Acting Conservation Commission Chair, regarding Highland Subdivision. And another one from Jack Roberts, Acting Conservation Commission Chair, regarding the Cantor Lane project. And there's an assignment of joint venture agreement regarding Dominica's Crossing and Navic Land Associates. Is there anything else that needs to be added at this point? The first item of all business, the Highland Subdivision Amendments, request by Peter Kennedy for amendments to the previously approved Highland Subdivision that include relocating the water line located in the area of Hunts Point Road and Winding Way, Section 19-3-9, Wetlands Alteration Permit Public Hearing, and Section 16-2-5, Amendment to Previously Approved Subdivision. As in the past, I will be excusing myself on this particular item, and the Vice Chair is not here this evening. Decided to call upon Mr. Etzel to act as Chair for this item and also the next one, which I will have to excuse myself from as well.
Mr. Chairman, I also have a conflict on this item and will have to be recused.
Okay.
Oops, that's right. As was mentioned, this is an amendment to a subdivision, including a relocation water line, lengthening a gravel portion of emergency access road, and converting a cul-de-sac to a hammerhead turnaround. I think this, we last left off with this application with a public hearing that was actually left open, was not closed. We will reopen that public hearing if there are members of the public who wish to make comment. I'll address those issues in just a second. I think before we get started with the public hearing other discussion, also the public hearing, would, after which we probably will allow the, would like to allow the applicant to respond to any of those comments that they read in the approved meeting minutes from that meeting. But before we start that, I just would like to ask the representative of the applicant to bring us up to date where it stands right now, the changes, if you could briefly summarize the changes that were made since our last meeting, and then we will go back to the public hearing.
Yes, I can do that. Thank you. Good evening. My name is Stephen Moore. I am a landscape architect with Moore & Sheridan here this evening on behalf of Peter Kennedy, who is Greater Portland Development Group. I just want to start off by thanking the board and the public for their patience in bringing this back to a public hearing. We appreciate that everyone here was here in November and had a chance to make their comments. We have been working since that time to revise the plans to reflect those comments. So we do appreciate the patience of the public and the board in finally bringing this back to the public hearing. As the board recalls, at November, at the time of the public hearing, there was an approximately 6 or 8 page memo from Fred Morin, the town engineer, that addressed a litany of concerns about accuracies in the plan and changes in the plan, and requested a number of additional pieces of information. In addition, the public at that public hearing had raised also a series of questions about wetlands impacts, about traffic, about the configuration of the project, the use of the emergency access road, and the drainage and wetlands issues related to the water lines. What I'd like to do for the benefit of the public and board is just step back, quickly walk through what the proposal is, and then focus for about 2 or 3 minutes on what has transpired in an overview since November in terms of the plans, and then just conclude with some specific comments about the plans before you. The amendment, to sort of recapture this, is an amendment that is proposing to take the 8-inch water line out of the emergency access way, where it was originally designed to come entirely under the emergency access way, and connect in a loop form to provide all of Broad Cove the looped water main that was needed by the entire subdivision, and to instead take that water line, come partway down the emergency access road, about 650 feet, and then turn to the north and connect via a new easement on Mr. Kennedy's land, and then through an existing right-of-way that was part of the original Balfour subdivision out to Hunts Point Road. The purpose in doing this was really threefold. First was to make sure that the subdivision would still comply with what this board had looked at originally, which was the need to get a water system back into Broad Cove. That was the major consideration. The second consideration was the issue of changing that alignment so that the installation of that line would become financially feasible. One of the issues with the project for Mr. Kennedy was the cost of the road and the cost of the water line were making this Phase 1B financially infeasible. The third one was to work in concert with a second change, which was to change the existing emergency access road back and make it longer and delete some of the paving. So there are really three forces behind the waterline changes. The second change on the proposed plan was to shorten the cul-de-sac. Previously, the cul-de-sac had extended approximately 600 feet additionally into the subdivision to provide a turnaround and cul-de-sac for lots 5 and 6. The proposal in front of you is to shorten that down to the hammerhead that's shown on the plans and provide then just a hammerhead turnaround and a shorter paved section into the lot. Because the board had acted on this subdivision previously with public access waivers, this change doesn't require additional activity by the board, additional actions by the board. In association with those two changes, what has to happen is that the emergency access gravelled drive has to be extended. Where the pavement from the cul-de-sac was deleted, the emergency access road essentially is then extended to meet the paved way. And then because of those changes and the change in the waterline location, the lots have to be reconfigured. And by reconfigured, what I'm saying is that, as shown in the plans, lot 6 loses the bulge that was created by the cul-de-sac, and then lots 5 and 6 have to have fingers or arms extended to achieve frontage on the waterline that's now heading up to Hunts Point Road. So those are the real key changes on the plan itself. As a result of that realignment, what happens is that the water line and the two water services to lot 5 and 6 have to extend through wetland areas. So what we're coming before the board as a part of this change is to request a special permit for a temporary disturbance to an RP1 wetland. And what we set forth in our information to you is the outline and the response to that. So since November, knowing that that was the essential plan or package, what we have done is go back to the drawing boards and revise a substantial number of the drawings to reflect Fred's comments, Fred Moore and the town engineer's comments. Specifically, we've revised a great number of the details that refer to drainage, to the stormwater design of the road extension, to the lot configuration, and to the water line to reflect what Fred was asking for additional information. Along with those changes, we have made several other changes that relate to the actual road layout in terms of final grading and the final details, which we've been working iteratively with Fred to review our drawings. So many of the changes that have occurred since November really reflect the technical details that Fred has been asking for in terms of road cross-section, erosion control, drainage, pavement design, culvert design, and waterline details in terms of installation. The couple of key changes that I think the board and the public would want to be aware of in terms of things that have happened since November and the feedback we've been getting from Portland Water District and the town engineer are first and foremost that the lot configuration has stayed fairly much the same as they had seen previously, but the waterline accessing lot 6 has been moved so that it comes across the corner of lot 5 by an easement, so we've lessened our temporary wetland impact in the upper corner of lot 5 and lot 6. Secondarily, we've been working with Portland Water District to try and establish a construction plan and then working with the private contractor to establish a construction plan to arrive at how we'd actually install those water lines and services to the lots so that we could provide to you detailed information on how we'd be building the water lines to demonstrate to you what our impacts would be on the wetland crossings. And then lastly, the other change is we are showing the locations of the temporary chains and emergency access stops in a different location than what the board has seen previously. And I'll show it on this scale because it's much easier. In the previous plans that the board and public had seen, we had the emergency access gates located deep into lot 4, here and here. What we're proposing and showing on this plan is what the board approved originally at the time of the amendment, which is that emergency access would occur out at the end of the paved road just beyond Colleen Tainter's lot here, and then it would also occur just at the backside of the building envelope on 4. So everything going through the pond and where the wetland is closest remains emergency access only. So there'll be no vehicular access into those lots from the existing way coming in past Colleen's lot. To just look again and address some of the specific issues that are back before the board tonight, I want to bring to the board's attention just to several things. First of all, we did have a chance to look over Fred Warren's memo to us. And I noticed that in the board's information that's been presented to them, there are several concerns about Fred Warren's memo. We can address all of those technical issues that Fred has raised about correcting cross-sections, getting a drainage issue solved just north of the new road. These are fairly fine points. We are comfortable we can respond to those, and we agree with Fred's comments in what he's put forward in his memo. With respect to Fred's comments and your memo to you about the wetlands alteration, I'd like to close with just a couple of thoughts on that. We have spent considerable time in our office working with Portland Water District and their construction chief and their construction engineer, David Coffin, as well as R.E. Coleman, who's the contractor who will be installing the private service lines. We worked with them to develop the construction plan that is set forth in the wetlands alteration application that's before you. We're confident that the 14-foot wide corridor is one that we believe is entirely workable, and that we know from both R.E. Coleman and from Portland Water District, they in fact have bought into and owned part of that construction plan. So we have every comfort that we know on the technical side we can build within the corridor that we've set forward with you and in our application to you that arrives at that disturbance of 4,188 square feet. And believe me, we originally had that narrow, as Fred mentioned, and we've worked through that several times, knowing that in some locations our wetlands disturbance will be somewhere out around that 12-foot width. We also know in other locations that wetlands disturbance is going to be down at just the width of the trench box at 6 feet. And as set forth in the Conservation Commission's memo to you late last year, we are specifying that those existing Scarborough soils be stockpiled and those hydric soils then be reused. And that we have specified a northeast wetlands mix, which is primarily sedge and rushes, that we know will take in there. So we feel confident that we've moved forward with a plan that we know is workable and also meets the test of your ordinance. And I recognize that you have information from Conservation Commission that speaks to the issue of feasibility. But I think what brought this forward to the board initially was the whole issue of financial feasibility. Peter wants to get this project going and moving, and the financial issue has been his major hurdle. And this alternative for the waterline location is, in fact, the one financially feasible alternative that Peter has to move this project forward. In closing, in terms of time schedule, I know a number of the neighbors are completely dissatisfied with the condition of the site, with Peter's repeated failure to perform and clean that site up. We're aware of that. We've discussed that with Peter. I know Peter has been talking with the town manager and has established those performance bonds amounts. And I have it from Peter that he is proposing to start construction on this as soon as the frost starts to get out. We're looking at March or April as a potential construction start to move this forward and get closure on this spring and early summer in terms of work and construction. So that's the construction schedule, and that's what we're looking at for completion of operations. And the intent is to bring this back into conformance with what the town is looking for, and also give Peter then the viable project that he needs to move forward. So with that, I trust I've met the board's wishes for a brief encapsulation. I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you, Steve. At this time, after those comments, I will reopen the public hearing that was not closed at the end of the last meeting, which was December, I think, the hearing. November. I do see some familiar faces, a couple that spoke before. I'm not going to say members can't speak a second time. I would just ask that we have a record what was said last time. If you want to reiterate a point, just simply say that you want to emphasize that point. If the other members want to speak, I would just ask to be precise. If you're re-emphasizing a point that's already been made, simply state so. I would also try to urge you to make constructive comments how this board might be able to work with this application that's before us. At this time, I'll reopen the public hearing and ask if there are any public members who would like to speak. Yes, sir, in the back. If each person could simply identify themselves, you could come to the podium.
Good evening, Mr. Acting Chairman. members of the planning board. My name is Bruce Gasquet, and I'm a resident at 82 Hunts Point Road. Very briefly, before I start here, just a quick comment. Rome wasn't built in a day, but it took considerably less than this project. Please consider my previous request and those of my neighbors to deny a wetlands alteration permit to Peter Kennedy for the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision. Mr. Kennedy has a history of violations of the wetlands ordinance on this project, and it appears that the town has not enforced resolution of those violations. Mr. Kennedy originally violated the ordinance by disturbing wetlands 2 years ago. The town ordered him to restore wetlands to their original condition at that time. I see no indication that he has complied with that order in any way. In addition, much of the original fencing erected to protect wetlands from soil erosion has collapsed, and there is runoff into the wetlands. Vast areas which were formerly forested now have been denuded for no apparent reason. How can this planning board now consider allowing the applicant to dig up virgin wetlands? If the town cannot enforce the wetlands ordinance, why doesn't the town call on the performance bond and make sure the work is done correctly according to the approved subdivision plan? I find it inconceivable that any developer who has unresolved code enforcement violations is even allowed to continue with the project until those issues have been resolved. In light of the town of Cape Elizabeth, with the exception of the planning board and the town planner, and the DEP's lack of interest in violations of wetland ordinance, I have drafted and sent a letter to Secretary of Interior Babbitt requesting that his office review this subdivision. I am aghast that the wealthiest town in the state, which claims that natural resources are its greatest asset, takes so little interest in these resources. Once a project has been approved by the planning board, I see no evidence of code enforcement at either the local or state level. I thank the planning board for its support in the past, and I know you will make an appropriate decision. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public wish to speak? Yes, sir.
My name is Dan Boxer. I actually have two questions, if I could, and I'll try not to repeat what I said last time. I also have something in my throat. My questions really relate, Steve, to construction that you're going to, or that you've described to the board. Is there any plan to make this part of, I don't know if I'm looking at the right end, the part off of Hunts Point Road, a farm pond road, to make that a narrower, less intrusive road? That was one of my comments last time, and I couldn't tell from your comments to the board whether that was dealt with.
I think what I'd like to do is stockpile the questions, right, and then let the applicant answer those at the end of the public hearing.
I didn't want to repeat myself, but the two issues that I addressed last time, I just couldn't tell from what Steve said whether they've been addressed. So if I could ask the board to have some clarification when Steve gets up on that point. And the second point that I made last time was that there's a huge drainage ditch that is off of that part of Farm Pond Road, which didn't weather very well, and to me it's a structure that just doesn't need to exist with a scaled down paved area. It isn't going to have to pick up as much runoff, and it seems to me that in any reconfiguration and finalization of those plans, that drainage ditch, which really is a very ugly thing, ought to be dealt with. And I couldn't tell from the discussion on drainage whether there was any plan to do that. On the road issue, I can't conceive of any reason why, if we're cutting out pavement by cutting out the cul-de-sac, we're going to make that paved road shorter. You wouldn't make it look more in keeping with what you'd expect something to look like as an access for two or maybe three houses. I get confused. What we have on the books now looks like a road that would service a large subdivision. It's wide and it's ugly and it's just unnecessary, and it's going to involve, if that road is kept at the width it's kept at, it's going to involve cutting trees and and extensive berms, and it just doesn't make sense for the area. So I urge you to not create a speedway right off Hunts Point Road that isn't necessary. Having said that, I want to just address one other point also, which is, I know there's some people who are very frustrated. You asked us to be positive, Mr. Chairman, so I'm not going to talk about my frustration. I'm going to take Steve's word for it that something is finally going to be done. People on our end, on the Hunts Point Road side end, are not really involved in the particular wetlands issue, so I don't think you're going to hear any comment on that. But we certainly don't agree with people who want the application denied because we've had to live with the mess. We think something ought to be approved, the right plan ought to be approved, and ought to be approved promptly so that we can get rid of the mess that some of us had to live with for maybe 3 years now. Time flies. At least as far as I'm concerned, I would urge you to approve something promptly, hopefully with the changes that we've been requesting. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public who would like to speak? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. And initially, before we start board discussion, I'd ask the applicant perhaps if you could respond to those last two questions. First, the question about any effort to narrow the road, Farm Pond Road on the east end, I believe it would be, and secondly, from an engineering perspective, because of the change of that road structure, does the drainage ditch need to still be the same size that was originally designed, or has it been changed?
I'll start with the latter one because it's the easiest one to answer. The ditch that's there is very badly eroded, and it is approximately 3 times larger than what's needed for what the volume is of water and drainage that would be coming off the project. As a part of the plans, what's proposed is to restore that channel back down to a narrower width and a shorter length in terms of what's deeply eroded by riprapping the bottom of the channel, restoring the two side slopes, reseeding them after they're filled at the time that the two catch basins and drain are in. So I think the short answer is yes, that drainage ditch as you see it today is going to disappear by about 60% of its volume, depth, and width through the restoration work that's shown on the plans. Because I think Dan's characterization of it is accurate. It's an area that because of the stop of work and the areas clear of vegetation, it's just increasingly eroded and undercut and enlarged itself over the past 3 to 5 years. So that will be pulled back and restored. And then go to Dan's first question. If I understand that, what you're asking is where the pavement currently comes off of running way and it's very wide. The gravel is wide, the pavement is wide where it sweeps in before it necks down into the proposed Hammerhead Road. That's all going to be turned over and narrowed down so that we just keep our paved way down to the width as it's shown on the plans. And all that disturbed wide throat will be necked down so that when you enter into Jordan Farm Road, it will be an intersection that is typical to all the other intersections within Broad Cove. So it won't be that highly disturbed, overly wide area. We have a paved apron that conforms with the town ordinance that then sweeps into the narrow road as it extends by Levitt and Boxer and then back into the interior. I hope that addressed your, did I understand your question correctly?
Just for a point of clarity, I'll allow Mr. Boxer to rephrase the question, I guess. Okay. That was going to be my question, if you could, just for a point of clarity for the public, and so we all don't have to open 100-scale plans here, just...
The proposed...
Try to tell us what the width, both at the beginning of that entryway and the actual paved, what you're proposing to be the paved surface width.
What's proposed is paving on the current plans is 22 feet. We taper where we meet your road, if I can call it that. We taper from a width right now of about 28 feet and taper around that radius very rapidly down to the 22 feet. On the previous plans, our width was out at 24 feet plus the sidewalks and shoulders. So we've pulled that in a little bit to get it narrower coming in and then pulled that tapered or radius curve down to enter in. Comparing that to the existing disturbed area, the existing disturbed area is about 34 or 36 feet wide out there now.
I guess to bring you more clarity to it, if at what does the plan show the width of the opening into the east end of Farm Pond Road at the existing paved edge, point to point? That would be the fullest width of the display of that entry. Then we understand that at whatever the radius is, it tapers down.
Our full width at radius point to radius point, in other words, outside, is 28 feet, but the curves drop in, so within several feet, it immediately then tapers down to that 22-foot width.
So according to the plan, the full width of that opening to the road would be 28 feet at current road's edge, down to 22 feet.
22, as soon as you get past the curves into the project.
Okay. The other question, and similar in light, would be, from the plans, can you just, for public knowledge, indicate what the width, you said it would be a reduction of 60%, this is regarding the drainage ditch, what from the top of slope, what the width would be?
We are showing where the pipe passes out of the catch basins into that drainage basin. Currently, that drainage basin is about 24 to 28 feet wide at top of bank, and it tapers out and widens.
Mm-hmm.
We're pulling that down to about 12 feet at the bottom of that culvert, where the culvert releases out, and then grading the slopes back. So that at the top of the bank, it'll remain essentially the same, but because we're filling, we're narrowing the channel moving through.
So top of the slope, to the top of the slope, that hole would be approximately the same size?
Approximately the same. But the side slopes will be smooth and the bottom of the channel will be narrowed down to about 12 feet.
Okay. I guess at this point I'd like to open up the discussion.
Two other points to clarify for the board. The wetlands were characterized as virgin wetlands. They are not virgin wetlands. They are disturbed wetlands.
And I guess, and then I had said that at the beginning of this, that I would let you, the applicant, before we moved on to general discussion, respond to any comments that were brought up in your absence when this public hearing started, if you wish to address any of those, if you remember any of those.
I don't. I just wanted to clarify that.
Okay, fine. Open up board discussion. Ask questions, make comments to the applicant. Anybody wish to go first? Don't all raise your hand at once. Roy, go ahead.
Something just came up about disturbed or virgin wetlands. If they're disturbed, why are they disturbed? I mean, is that the history of when you were there 3 or 4 years ago, or is that another term used for heavily used wetlands?
Disturbed in this term means that they are not natives that were wet. They are not wetlands that were native to that site, because this entire site was stripped for topsoil, mined for topsoil by Allan Balfour back when the original subdivision was done. So what you see on this site in terms of wetlands are wetlands that have come in and infilled into soils that are hydric because of changes in the surface created by man-made activities. So the wetlands that are out there through much of this site are the result of activities dating back 20 or 25 years or 30 years. And hence the term disturbed. So when you dig through and you look at the vegetative type, they are natural vegetation, naturally occurring vegetation, because they've successively come into here. But the whole site was stripped and mined as I said, when Balfour came in here. So I use that term so that the board has some context or understanding of what they're seeing for wetlands.
Fine, thank you. Another question on the timetable. Would the putting in that water line be the first priority, or would you first clean up that property and start moving those? I was on the property today again. All the mounds of broken up asphalt and mounds of, and the drainage ditch, which we referred to a little while ago, or would the first endeavor be putting that water line through?
The way the construction plan is proposed right now, the very first activity would be to go back out, restore all of the silt fences, get all of the erosion controls properly set up, and then while that is going on, Portland Water District would mobilize and install their cross-country main. So those things would go hand in hand initially. Once the Portland Water District had gone in and was beyond where the service laterals are shown on the drawing, then the private contractor would come in and be installing those service laterals while the Portland Water District finishes their connection to Hunts Point Road. And only at that point, when those two work operations were done, would then the balance of that work be done with the extension and graveling of the emergency access road, the construction of the Hammerhead Spur, and then the drainage installation and drainage ditch repair on the east end of the project.
And this will all be done prior to sale of the properties?
Yes. The conditions that you've set forth in your work is that there's no alteration of the property until all the conditions are met. I'm sorry, your question was until the sale of the properties are done? No, what we're saying is we're going to move ahead and do that construction work, and at the same time, PETA's going to try and sell and market these lots.
Thank you.
So, other questions? Mark?
Yes. Mr. Mark, could you review what the actual precautions are that take place within the 14-wide foot strip where the water main is going to be run through? Does that involve protecting existing plantings from layoff material? And also, could you speak a little bit to what there would be in terms of survey control or making sure that work is taking place in the right place this time around?
The measures as we've specified them are that we are setting up silt fence to the left and the right of center line, if you will, at 7 feet. So we have those permanently installed prior to the start of excavation. We've then specified that the equipment has to come in and do the excavation and removal in the wetlands areas of that soil and the attendant plants in that soil. In the area where the 8-inch main is, we're anticipating that the trench itself is going to be 6 feet wide because the trench box itself requires that for setup for the depth and the size of the line. We anticipate within the wetland areas that we will not use any of those side areas after the hydric soils have been dredged as layoff areas. We'll be using the balance of the corridor, that 14-foot corridor, as the trenching operations proceed to layoff. We anticipate as we move out of Lot 4 and into the right-of-way that there will be an excess amount of material coming out that can occupy the 14-foot corridor. So we'll be using trucks backed in from the emergency right-of-way to grab that excess material and haul it off before it's laid off in that corridor. So we envision it as one sequential operation that works up through the corridor and then back down, backfilling as they move up the corridor. And then only once the whole corridor is cut will we go back in, replace the hydric soils, and then go about restoration. And as I mentioned earlier, we'd be coordinating with R.E. Coleman to do the service laterals once Portland Water District has passed the service lateral cutoff point and is moving towards Hunts Point Road. So we envision using most of that 14-foot corridor for temporary stockpiling of material as we move up through it. But in some areas, we know that we will be excavating and backfilling within a tighter corridor, like 8 feet or 10 feet. But we've deliberately set it out at 14, allowing for the track width and for material spilling out of buckets and disturbance of vegetation adjacent to that line. So we are anticipating within that 14-foot corridor that most of that vegetation will be either at a minimum driven over with the tracked equipment or possibly under temporary materials. With respect to the controls, what we are suggesting in our wetlands alteration is that we will go back in once the work is done and the rough grading is done and do our inspection of grades, because we have mandated that the contractor restore those grades to the original elevations so that we keep the same hydrology of the wetlands. That's going to be possible on the construction of the 8-inch main corridor coming through, but on the lateral, service laterals moving out, we are going to be shaping that because there's a drainage ditch that passes through there now. So we'll be deepening that to make sure that there's a positive flow in there. So we will be altering that grade slightly lower. But we've indicated that we will be doing monitoring through our office and through Owen Haskell's, but we haven't specified amount, times, or the degree to which we'll be actually out there checking it as the work is done. Did I answer all your questions?
Yes, thank you.
Peter?
I have one question, sir. You mentioned that with our approval, you hope to begin in March or early April. As far as the timing on the infrastructure, the road, the water line, the paving, protection of the wetlands, reseeding, and in cleaning up the site, what do you think would be a completion date of this project? Just the infrastructure.
Just the infrastructure, meaning water and road and...
Paving.
And paving.
And drainage and so forth.
Right now, what we're looking at for our schedule is that we want to get all of the heavy work, meaning cut, fill, gravel installation, catch basins, drainage, riprap, and waterline installation completed no later than May, May 15th, May 18th. Because what we want to do at that point is get our initial seeding by mid-May. We're looking at targeting our seeding operations between mid-May and mid-June. The only thing we've held off on setting a date for is actual paving, and that's why I asked that question. We're looking at paving then sometime out in the summer, meaning mid-June.
Along the same line, what's the time frame of the alteration of the wetlands itself, if you were to start that in mid March,
in April. Terms of, we'd like to get
all the time to get the truck started in there and back them out of there. To
complete
that phase of the construction.
We expect that's really going to happen in April, and that, based on the type of sedges and rush that are out there, is an appropriate time to get in there and do that work. But we look at actual operational time being about 7 or 10 days maximum that we would be in there for that disturbance of the wetlands.
Any other questions, comments, Maureen?
Through the chair, I think you talked about where you're going to put the post and chains, and if I understood you correctly, one of them is going to be basically at the border between Phase 1A and 1B, and the other one was supposed to be easterly of the waterline easement. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So one of those Lot 4 building envelopes is no longer viable, correct?
What we've said on the plan, and the note on the plan, is that in the event that Lot 4B, that building window, is used, then that chain gets moved back to the other side of 4B.
Okay. So you're still looking at that option, and in fact, the post and chain could go in one of two locations.
That's correct. That's what's shown on the plan.
Could you just show us quickly which 4A and 4B is?
Yes. 4A, I believe, is the one that's easterly of on Lot 4. So it's the one that sits immediately adjacent to Lot 5. And 4B is the one that sits westerly of the waterline easement. So in the event that 4A is utilized, that chain goes up just about 60 feet east of the waterline easement, about where my pen is here. And in the event that 4B is used, that chain moves back approximately 130 feet westerly of the easement and sits right about where my pen is here.
Okay, good. I guess the, one of the things I struggle with, and I sense the rest of the board struggles with, dealing with the past management of the site, you've presented a very clear picture of how you propose to resolve the issues if amended. I think some of the things that the board is looking at is how does, in a reasonable manner, do we assist the, to make sure that the proper management takes place, that it does take place within a certain period of time. Another issue that comes up is this whole feasibility issue of that it's more feasible to lay this water line through wetlands and alter the wetlands. And I don't want it to be construed that we're selling environmental protection for the sake of development. But at the same time, and I'm trying to phrase this in a fair way, because we don't typically talk about issues of cost and other business-type issues as a planning board, but I think it's essential in making a good decision that we at least have some sense of this entire plan is based on economic feasibility. Can you give us some sense, without divulging business, better business practice, or however you want to phrase it, approximately how significant is the savings that will come about by going this method versus what's already approved, laying the line through the road? I guess I'm trying to make that as vague as possible without delving into your or the applicant's business. At the same time, you've presented this in the light that this whole amendment is based on the feasibility, economic feasibility, of making this change.
I think for the purposes of protecting Peter's interest, I'm going to express that. I can answer that question in terms of lots, of a value to a lot, if you will. You know from looking at the plan, what we're looking at in Phase 1B is three lots, 4, 5, and 6, in terms of the proposed development. If we take the change in cost of shortening the road and removing the cul-de-sac and taking away the pavement, and then changing the waterline location, the value of that work is equal to the sales price, approximately, of one of the lots. So I think most of you can understand what the value of a lot is in that area. And that's what we're looking at, is that the savings equates to recapturing, if you will, the value of one lot.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I guess a question, would the applicant, this is a public, we're currently designed, and I guess I'll put it up to consensus of the board, continuously shortening or proposing to shorten the east side or the east end of Farm Pond Road. It's presently at 22 feet. Is there any reason, from a design stand, I think our lowest level is 20 feet wide, other than public access waiver. Is there any reason it can't be reduced to 20 feet?
Technically, no. I think when we started this out, we had looked at pulling that down to 20 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And then in discussions with either Public Works or Fire Chief, we ended up putting out to 22. And I guess I'd have to pose the question back through the board to the town planner. I believe that was a Public Works or a Chief McGoldrick issue in terms of width. That's my recollection of it, of 20 versus 22.
I don't have any memo from the fire chief having him expressly supporting 22. He generally prefers wider roads because it's easier to maneuver his equipment.
I think the issue there is getting, I remember months back, probably years back now, the issue of the turning radius of that turn in from Hunts Point down Winding Way or Running
Way.
Tide, I can't remember which it is, but then back again is a tough turn for any large truck. But we're also talking about a very short road now into Farm Pond. What is the current, I don't want to haul my map out, what's the current
The radius? Current width is 22 feet. That's the proposed width of the road. We're working out calling Jordan Farm Road because for clarity's purposes, that entire road has now been named, instead of Farm Pond, it's become Jordan Farm. So we're carrying that at 22 feet of width. If it's the board's wish to narrow that to 20 feet, we can go back through and change plans and move that back down to 20 feet, but I'd have to go back and check my notes and try and understand why that was at a 22.
Yeah, I don't want to put you in the flip-flop position at the same time. Maureen mentioned that, you know, she doesn't have a recollection of that. At the same time, whether that was your recollection from Chief McGoldrick at the time that it was a longer road, the turning radius, the radius itself at that corner, at the intersection, has not changed. Is that correct?
It has not, no.
Is there any way, from an engineering perspective, to narrow the drainage ditch, or is that simply a function of slope to the size of the ditch required that Mr. Boxer mentioned in the public hearing?
There is a way to narrow that ditch. Right now, given the watershed coming into it, as I mentioned earlier, that full ditch cross-section is not needed for the hydraulic capacity, the watershed that goes into there. So the short answer is yes, you can narrow up the channel and then add fill on the side slopes as it moves further down through the site.
Okay. Again, without opening up my plans here, what's the current slope going into that ditch?
We're carrying a 3-to-1 side slope on the regraded sides going down to the bottom flow line or invert of the of the swale.
Okay, I'd ask also next to the planner, if you could bring us bring my memory back as to what the status of the performance guarantee, where we stand with that issue.
I could do that, but the town manager's in the audience, and I know he's here specifically.
I noticed him sitting there, and I figured that might be why he's here. So if you'd like to invite Mr. McGovern to respond to that.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. The developer has a letter of credit with the First Federal Savings Bank of Bath. I think that's the name of it, something like that. It is still in place. However, it does expire. I believe the date is the end of June, and is not extendable beyond that date without action by the board.
What's the amount of the letter of credit?
$193,715. And in addition, there's a waterline escrow account at Key Bank here in Cape Elizabeth for $48,781.13.
That's an escrow fund. Does it have a termination date on the escrow?
No.
Who are the signees of the escrow? The town of Cape Elizabeth?
The town. It's in the town's name.
And that is in addition to the 193?
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions of the town manager? Thank you. So I one last time, as far as the total time of construction, you're proposing that it was what you see as feasible. Really finishing the overall construction by the end of June, middle of June, the construction of the water, the wetlands alteration itself, if begun in say mid-April, would take a maximum of 7 to 10 days?
That's correct. The actual wetlands disturbance time would be 7 to 10 days. The completion of the water line beyond the last wetland up in the right-of-way will take about an additional 4 or 5 days, building beyond that. So the total elapsed time that Portland Water District has put forward to us on their schedule is just a little over 2 working weeks, about 12 working days.
Okay. That right-of-way that actually attaches or hooks to Hunts Point Road, will all of that construction take place from that end of the road?
No, the construction will take place from the emergency access side. We are not going to be running trucks down.
Okay, so all the construction will come from the Jordan Farm Pond Road side. Okay. Any other questions from the board? Comments?
I guess I'm interested to see if there's any consensus agreement, disagreement as far as changing the width of the paved road at the east end of Jordan Farm Pond Road. Meaning, see it reduced to 20 feet?
I have no objection, as long as the fire chief approves.
Okay. Roy?
I agree.
How about requesting narrowing the drainage ditch opening itself? Do you have any estimation, Steve, of what that could be narrowed to? We're presently 24 feet down to 12 at the base. Just from an engineering standard, do you know what the closure could be?
I really couldn't. I know that we could achieve a narrowing on the bottom of the channel down to as little as 8 feet and still keep the hydraulic capacity, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to sit down and study that to determine what that means for side slopes running back to the opening. But I think my general thought on it is you could narrow it by 25%
mm-hmm.
fairly readily without any real alteration of the character that's needed in that drainage area to make that flow properly and still achieve the 3-to-1 slopes and get it properly vegetated so it's stable. I think that's the key issue there.
Okay. Roy?
I have a question for the town planner. Is there, I don't know if this is really can be done or not, but can we hold back any building permits until all these other things have been satisfied?
Can I get back to you on that?
Certainly can. I don't mean it as a loaded question, but the purpose just being that we have some way of getting this done. We've been through it before. I'm only a resident here for the last 3 years, but some assurance other than a bond maybe that puts somewhat pressure on the developer to get the this work done. I would think he'd want to do it anyway to possibly increase the marketability of the three lots.
Okay.
Thank you.
Other comments? Concerns? Do I hear a motion?
I'll do it.
Roy, go ahead.
Motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, 1, Peter Kennedy is requesting approval to relocate a water line, lengthen the gravel portion of the emergency access road, and convert the cul-de-sac to a hammerhead turnaround located in the area of Jordan Farm Road, Winding Way, and Hunts Point Road. 2, the application requires review under Section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision, and Section 19-3-9-04, and Section 19-3-9-05, Wetlands Regulations. 3, the town engineer has identified several inconsistencies in the plans which should be resolved prior to construction to facilitate construction and enforcement consistent with the planning board approval. 4, the town manager has recommended changes and updates to the performance guarantees currently held by the town. 5, the application substantially complies with Section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision, and Section 19-3-9-04, and Section 19-3-9-05, Wetlands Regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and material submitted, the application of Peter Kennedy for a wetlands alteration permit for the location of a water line in the Highland subdivision located in the vicinity of Jordan Farm Road, Winding Way, and Hunts Point Road Extension, and an amendment to the previously approved subdivision be approved, subject to the following condition. 1, that the plans be revised per the comments of the town engineer's letter dated 2/12/96, that a performance guarantee be submitted to the town in a form acceptable to the town manager and town attorney, that there be no alteration to the site until the above conditions have been satisfied. 4, with some discussion about the entrance off Winding Way, based on the approval of the fire chief, would be reduced to 20 feet, and five on the drainage. We had some numbers on that, didn't we? 12, what was the...
I might just remind, to recommend or suggest that that condition read, that drainage ditch be reduced to the minimal required dimensions. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Further discussion on the motion itself. Maureen?
Well, just to get back to Mr. Carlson's question, I wanted to check it. The subdivision ordinance gives the planning board complete discretion over the performance guarantee. It doesn't say specifically that you can withhold building permits, but it says that you are allowed to schedule, to approve the construction schedule, and that you can determine when required improvements shall be completed. And it talks in terms of years, but I think it's clearly implied that if you wanted to talk about when required improvements must be completed prior to something else, say the issuance of a building permit, my interpretation right now is that you could do that. The only other comment I wanted to make is I would just suggest that in the proposed motion that the condition number 3 be moved to condition number 5. And what that will do is require that the two additions that you've made would have to be shown on the plans before there would be any construction on the site.
Thank you. So amended?
Good point. In the sense that it says above condition?
Yeah.
Just a minor change on what is now number 3. Your phraseology was similar to the based on the approval of the fire chief, that I think you said the opening. And I think we should change that to the width of the travelway, paved travelway. And just for my own recollection, number 4. Okay, 4 is the condition to reduce the width of the drainage ditch to a minimum allowable by engineering standards, whatever. Maureen's working on phraseology, I'm sure, right, as we speak. No. Number 5, back to number 2. I'd like to call the town manager back again, just so it's clear in my mind that how this would function. I mean, there's the issue of placing restrictions on building permits, but there's also the reality of the issue of we have a letter of credit in place that is not renewable. Can you just explain to me and the board how the present structure of what exists and what you foresee as a performance guarantee would, in all likelihood, require that all of that construction be done by June 30th?
Based on the assurances given by Mr. Moore on behalf of the developer, there should not be any concern on the part of the developer of having that restriction as part of the approval.
Okay.
Could I address something else while I'm here?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, the amount of the letter of credit should be $157,300. That's based on a recommendation from the town engineer on November 14th,
1995. So the total runs at about $195,000.
Plus the water
loss,
correct.
Right. Okay.
No, the 190 something was based on the earlier letter of credit and the earlier work.
But
this amount is based on the town engineer's review of the plans that were in place as of November 15th.
Okay, thanks. Any other questions, comments, discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read and amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed?
It's unanimous vote, 4-0. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Again, to the public and board, we appreciate your patience in putting up with getting to this point.
We look forward to having that phase of subdivision completed. Thank you. My understanding is that I'm also chairing the next section, or the next article, and I'm not quite ready because I didn't know I was going to do that, so I'm going to move over there and I'll be right back.
Everybody's written a letter.
Thank you very much. And the next article, if people are leaving the hall, if you could refrain from talking until you get outside the hall, makes it a little bit easier to hear. Next item on the agenda is the Candle Lane project, the request by Shore Woods, Inc., Sagamon Associates, Inc., and Candor Corp. for a wetlands alteration permit and public access waiver for three lots, U23-3-2, 3-4, 3-3, located off Candor Lane, section 19-3-9, wetland alteration permit public hearing, and section 19-2-2B, public access waiver. Maureen, while I quickly shuffle papers here, could you just sort of bring us up to speed on this application? And then we'll have the applicant address the board.
There is an existing five-lot subdivision, and four of the lots are before the board tonight for a combination of public access waivers and wetland alteration permits. The lots were created several years ago, and what you'd be reviewing tonight would be public access waivers for three of the lots and the wetland alteration permit basically for the access road that is proposed. It crosses mostly lot one, and also an existing pond that was created last spring on, I believe it is lot two. At the last meeting, the board deemed the application complete, and a public hearing has been scheduled and advertised for tonight's meeting. Are there any questions?
None right now. I'd invite the representative, the applicant, to just briefly describe where we are now, changes made since the last meeting, and then we'll proceed to a public hearing.
Okay. My name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates. And I represent the three applicants for this project. First is lot one, Sagamon Associates. Lot four is Cantor Corp. And lot five is Shore Woods, Inc. The applicant is requesting three items, as Maureen indicated. The wetland special permit for crossing an RP2 wetland in this location here with an access road. The second item is a public access waiver. Since lots 1 and 5 do not have the required frontage on a public way, we're required to obtain a public access waiver. And we are asking for one waiver, as I indicated at the last meeting, from the standards of public access waiver, and that is to reduce the width of the pavement from the required 22 feet down to 14-foot wide pavement with 2-foot grass shoulders, gravel underneath. And the third item is a wetland restoration plan for this pond located on the east side of existing Cantor Lane. The pond was excavated during the spring of 1995. And in accordance with the ordinance, we have fulfilled the requirements, the list of requirements under section 19-3-9-11, and are found in our submission package. We have received the correspondence from both the town planner and the town engineer. We responded to those comments. The letter in your packet this month responses to the planning board members, some of the members' concerns or questions at the last meeting. We attempted to respond and address those concerns, and I'll be glad to discuss any of those that you wish. We have also met, as you know, we've met with the Conservation Commission last Thursday. We went over a number of questions and comments that they had and have responded to their concerns. We most recently have responded to there's been recent correspondence by the town engineer and the town planner, and we've responded to those concerns also, and I realize that you don't have those comments because it was just done last week, but I do want to indicate that we've responded to those concerns. And with that, I'll open it up for questions. Steve Pelletier from Woodlot Alternatives is here with me this evening to answer any questions regarding wetland impacts on the project.
Okay. I think before we go into any questions and debate with the board, I'll open up the public hearing on the wetlands alteration, which we're required to do by notice. So at this time, I will open the public hearing regarding the wetlands alteration permit. Again, I'd ask any members of the board of the public which would like to speak, just simply identify yourself when you come to the podium. Any members of the public? Yes, sir.
Am I addressing the wetlands alteration permit and also the access road or the maintenance
one? Let me check with the... Do both at the same time.
I'm Tim Robinson, and I've written a letter to each one of you, and I hope you've had an opportunity to read it. But in the event you haven't, or in any case, to address anybody here in the gathered who might be interested, I'm the owner of 85 acres of land to the north and east of the 42 acres that are going to be developed, and my four sons are the owners of 50 acres of land to the northwest of that area. Basically, I have two concerns about this. Having to do with the invasion of wetland that will be involved in the way in which the proposed access road will be go through what is identified as Wetlands 1 here. There is in Lot 1 a significant amount of land which is not wetlands, but the proposed road goes through the wetlands. Now, there are, I think, four wetland areas in the entire 43 acres that are going to be about, by 43 acres, I mean all of us, not just the three lots that are involved here. So I'm concerned, and I think everyone should be concerned, about not only the impact, the wetlands impact on what is proposed here and the way in which the access road is going to be placed, but also the impact that it potentially might have on the entire watershed, which flows generally northwest to the Byers, what used to be known as Byers Pond and Pond Cove Brook, which flows ultimately to the sea at Pond Cove. Now, Byers Pond, which is Robinson Pond now, is entirely within our property, is fed by Pond Cove Brook, a south branch and a north branch. The south branch begins in the Hayward property, flows through Julianne Lane, which is accessed from Shore Road, flows through Peach Bluff Terrace, and then into our property. So there has been for many years a possibility of pollution of water that flows to, an interruption of a flow of water that goes to the pond and to Pond Cove Brook. Secondly, the north branch of Pond Cove starts at Hodstone, west of Mitchell Road, flows through Cranbrook and into the Byers Pond, the Robinson Pond, from the north side. Significantly, the wetland areas that are here in this proposed development also feed this area. So the general flow of water from here is northwest to into the pond. Now, the pond is described in the engineer's report as a small pond west of Jordan Lane. It is, I think, and as I've said in my letter, an environmentally significant area. It is, it has pickerel in it, it has otter in it, it has muskrat in it, it has turtles in it, it has deer in the surrounding woodlands, deer, fox, porcupine, and various other small animals. So I think it's a significant area. What happens here can potentially affect this entire area. Now, this our family has always welcomed people in this area to walk, ski, snowshoe. We have not wanted them to build fires and bring vehicles in there. So a lot of people enjoy that, people who are in the various, about the property and who are in the community. So what I'm trying to say is that this is a significant area from an environmental standpoint and is worthy of your consideration in terms of what happens here in this area and what will become of the flow of water. Now, I can't address very specific things like the location of the road, the width of the road, the number of culverts and such. All this, I think, is tremendously important in terms of preserving what is a very significant area of open land, open space land, that is the home to a lot of wildlife and also aquatic animals and birds. So I'm simply speaking here to urge you to consider not only the impact of this particular road here, but also the impact on an entire area of Cape Elizabeth, which I think is important, not just to our family, the landowner, but also to a lot of people in the community.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public who would like to speak? Yes, sir.
I'm Avery Houghton. I live down on Old Colony Lane, and I abut some of the Robinson property, and one of the fortunate few who do have an opportunity to enjoy the Robinson property and have visually seen all of the animals and birds and whatnot that Mr. Robinson talks about. My concern here, obviously, is with the flora and fauna of that area, but a bigger concern is what is going to happen to the water and the wetlands as they drain down into Robinson Pond and go by my property, which is part of the wetland area that the Pond Cove stream flows into. And I just simply support Mr. Robinson in his quest to you to be sure that what is done on these roads is done environmentally correctly. In order to not in any way diminish the wonderful sights that we have out back there and the pure water that we have coming down through. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? Any other members of the, yes, ma'am.
I'm Carol Haas. I live in the Sherwood Forest area, which is further north even than the Robinson property. And I'm concerned that I want to make sure that you're realizing that this entire area is a very important one to many of us who live along Shore Road and further north. I wanted to make you aware that currently, through the generosity of the Robinson family, who has always allowed us to walk and enjoy their property, people who live as far north as the Oakhurst area can walk through the woods down behind where I live in Sherwood Forest. They can go through the Dyer Pond area, through Canterbury, through the Robinson family property, and along a pathway that I believe goes right through this area that's up for discussion and takes us all the way into the town center by the Methodist Church. This is very good for us to be able to do. We enjoy hiking along this area. It's a very important and significant area ecologically as well as aesthetically, and I'm concerned that the public not be denied the opportunity to continue at least to, if not follow the existing trail, at least to be able to make that pathway, which has been so helpful for us. Does anybody have any questions about that? I know you might not know.
I think that some questions will come up after we close the public hearing regarding it. Thank you very much. Anybody else from the public would like to speak? Seeing and hearing none, I close the public hearing. Ask the applicant to return to the podium and open it up now to discussion from the board. Any questions, comments? Somber-looking group tonight.
I'll start off. Again, as I said at the last meeting, I was not at the workshop session the evening that this came in at workshop. I think my comments are more appropriate to that forum, but I think the planning board is in a very difficult situation here this evening, because what we have in front of us is what the applicant refers to as not a subdivision application. Clearly, it's a public access and wetland alteration permit application. However, that's not to say that because somebody at some point drew four or five lots on the face of the earth, that they did so necessarily with the best interest in the town in mind. For example, at our last workshop meeting, we had an applicant come before us with a subdivision that was proposed and registered back in the 50s. Most of the lots in that subdivision are in resource protection areas. That are literally, most of the subdivision was unbuildable. So one of my questions is with respect to the location of the road. It just does not seem, given the area that's before us here and the fact that there once existed a 40-foot right-of-way, albeit as the applicant states in the correspondence, that the old 40-foot right-of-way would have created a greater wetland impact. It also appears to be closer to two existing house lots, and that may also provide a reason for its being proposed relocation. In addition, one of the abutters or one of the applicants encroached on that right-of-way by extending a pond. I'm really torn between an issue of accepting this as a five-lot subdivision and where's the best place to put the road versus there are three building lots here. They're all well in excess of the minimum lot size required under the ordinance, and I don't understand why the planning board should be approving access entirely or primarily through a wetland to access upland lots to accommodate a preconceived subdivision plan that does not respect the natural features of the site. And that's really something that I know it's a tremendous hardship to the applicant to reconfigure the subdivision parcel in order to place the road in an upland area, but I don't know that, given the land area that's available and concern about impacts, that that's an unreasonable suggestion. I'm not convinced that the road can't be placed in an upland location. I think part of the hardship rests with the applicant, not with with the fact that that these lots were preconceived with disregard, I think, to the natural conditions on the site, to have left the right-of-way through clearly what is the most sensitive wetland area of the site. Simply a site inspection, I would believe, would indicated that that probably was not the best place to do it. I don't have any issue with respect to the waiver to reduce the road width to 14 feet with the shoulders. I think that's acceptable to the fire chief and certainly is a standard that we've followed in the past and is consistent with our desire not to have driveways be any more than driveways or small roadways. And again, it may not have had to have gone through subdivision review because of the way in which the lots were transferred, but I think we have to assess the impacts of it based on our subdivision standards and site plan standards, and the issue of this road going through the wetland just doesn't ring right with me, and the discussion about the impacts on Lot 1 are not convincing to me. They just aren't. I think that there's plenty of land here to configure three lots on without having to develop the roadway through the wetland. That's the I guess the other question that I would have is with respect to the vernal pool. I'm not interested in making a mountain out of a molehill. The literature discussed several buffers, and the applicant has proposed a 50-foot buffer. There may be some discussion, I think, warranted about a larger buffer, but that's not a primary concern of mine at this point.
Other comments? Any response to those comments?
Well, I'm not going to argue whether it's a subdivision or not. That's been answered and addressed by the town attorney, that it's not, clearly not a subdivision. Never was and continues not to be. And I don't think that we should be held under the subdivision standards. We're applying for a public access waiver and a special wetland permit. It's unfortunate the lots are configured in such a way by the previous owner, but that's what we're faced with. We have done, as I've stated before, we have done everything to minimize the impact on the wetland by moving the road as high as we feel can be done. It's on the edge of the wetland, on the transitional edge of the wetland upland. Moving it further to the south is going to get us into steeper slopes. If you've been out there, you have witnessed the steep slopes and the ledge. It is also going to reduce the buffer between the roadway and the road in the potential home site. And let me restate again that, which I've stated in the past, the goal of the applicant is to develop a plan, three lots consisting of three lots, maintaining the existing character of Cantor Lane, and that is narrow roads, canopy of trees over the roadways, preservation of natural features such as steep slopes and ledge, vegetation and wetlands. By and also incorporating large lots. The average lot size here is 10.5 acres. Moving the road further to the south is going to significantly reduce the buffer between the roadway, or the limit of clearing for that roadway, and the potential home site. And in this case, it's right here. There's very steep slopes right here, unsuited for residential development. The most suited area is located right here. So for that reason, we have held the road to a point where we've met the town ordinance as far as site distance. It's on the middle of the straightaway. Again, moving it closer to the south is going to reduce the site distance. We're not going to be able to meet that. But more importantly, it's going to put that roadway within 40 or 50 feet of the front of the home, and that is not acceptable to the applicant.
May I just follow up?
Sure, go ahead, Tom.
There are a number of houses that have roadways within 40 or 50 feet of the front of the house. I feel like a fellow co-conspirator in this application. I never said it was a subdivision. Clearly, someone went to the effort to subdivide the land without the benefit of planning board input, and I think one lives with the consequences. I, as a planning board member, would prefer that the 40-foot right-of-way were used and you went ahead and proposed the road to go through the 40-foot right-of-way. That way, we can at least rest on the fact that this was a pre-existing subdivision that didn't require subdivision review. It had a dedicated 40-foot right-of-way. Here's the plan that was approved, and that's the way it is. Somehow, I feel brought into the the conspiracy here to work around the wetlands ordinance without having to deal with the subdivision ordinance, and I feel very uncomfortable doing that. I think at this point, if the planning board's involved with relocating this road within the wetland, it's appropriate to look at alternatives that involve relotting of the rest of the site.
Other comments, questions? Roy?
I have a question. The proposed driveway for Lot 1 is where?
We haven't shown that. It would probably be off of Cantor Lane between the two wetland areas.
So there again, you would have to be requiring a waiver, wetlands waiver on that driveway?
I don't believe so.
In previous discussions with the applicant, it was the, what we had talked about was identifying two specific locations where a driveway could go into Lot 1 without requiring further additional wetland alteration. The one location is on Cantor Lane, the other location is on the outside curve of the proposed access drive, but that was one of the issues that we had talked about, identifying those specifically and limiting a driveway to one of those two locations.
Further questions, comments?
Mr. Chair?
Mark?
Mr. Mitchell, there are two areas of concern that I have. I was wondering if you could address.
Sure.
Since workshop, we've been discussing the sort of comparative features of site planning, given the sort of constraints that we normally operate under the public access waiver. In reviewing my material for tonight's meeting, I noticed that the public access waiver refers to any road that requires a public access waiver to service three lots or more is referred to subdivision road building standards. Could you comment on the approach that would entail for this project versus the current planning of it? That's my first question. And secondly, have you given any consideration to the neighborhood trail access that currently runs through the site, and what do you plan to do regarding that?
Your first statement, are you saying that we would fall under the subdivision standards of a road for a public access?
The paragraph for public access waiver says that if the adequacy of street construction for streets serving three or more lots or dwelling units shall be determined by the standards set forth in section 632. And that's the subdivision ordinance. That's the paragraph in there where it tells you what the dimensional standards are for local versus feeder and whatnot roads. It apparently envisions that beyond a certain number of lots being served by the public access waiver, that you need a higher standard of physical attributes for the road itself. So I was wondering if you had looked at that before.
No, I haven't. I'm not sure that you mentioned three or more lots. Lot 4 has legal frontage on Ocean House Road. And technically, I'm not sure that that would require a public access waiver. I would need some interpretation on that.
Oh, okay. That's
We are requesting public access waiver for lots 1 and 5. With regard to your second question, we have had conversation with the Conservation Commission regarding public access. And the applicant has stated that he is very willing to sit down with the Conservation Commission in the town and or the town and talk about possible easements to allow the continuation of public access on or around this property.
Any other questions, comments?
Just an aside here, one of the pieces of correspondence on our podium tonight was a letter from Jack Roberts. I think it was perhaps summarizing. I haven't read it. That's the problem, is I haven't had a chance to take a look at it myself. I don't know what the other members have. And I guess because we're running behind schedule here now, I'm not sure that I want to take 5 minutes to review that at this point. But I mean, just making note that we haven't had a chance to take a look at that. Questions that I have, you refer to a dry hydrant serviced by the existing pond. Is the existing pond that you're talking about the pond that was created, or are we talking about the other pond?
It's the one that was created. It directly ties to the one that was created during the spring of 95. However, these ponds are interconnected, so the water would be, the source of water would be from both.
Are the calculations on acre feet based on both ponds?
Yes.
I get my only concern there, and it was the history of the pond. You know, if it's only created in 1995, does it have any history of drying out during a certain time period? You know, I don't know the engineering of the pond. I think it may be a good resolution I think worked with dry hydrants. I don't know if we've approved them, but certainly worked with them in other locations. I guess my comment would be to understanding engineering of the pond so that we don't approve a dry hydrant on a dry pond. I was not aware that they were connected, which may give some credence to that. It seemed to have some pretty good capacity.
Yes.
Have you spoken with the fire chief regarding that dry hydrant?
Yes.
I may have missed this.
I met with the fire chief, and we talked about the road width, and as I mentioned, we came to a compromise on that. And on the dry hydrant, if you remember, he initially recommended that we bring the water main in and put a permanent hydrant. The water main happens to be on Hill Way, and the applicant didn't want to get into bringing in an 8-inch water main with a hydrant. As a compromise, he is proposing to put a dry hydrant and tie it into the pond here.
Where would the actual location of the hydrant be? And I apologize if I didn't pick that up on the plan. Right at the corner?
Right at the corner.
Okay. Going back to the vernal pool issue and the buffer, did you have a copy of the literature that we received, or did you see that?
Yes.
Okay.
Marine supplied.
How much do you think, I'm sort of torn in this, and I'm a very strong advocate of protecting this very unique resource as best we can. One of the facts of the matter is about 30-40% of its buffer is actually closer to an abutter than it is. It doesn't give us the 50 feet there anyway. How much do you feel comfortable pushing that beyond a 50-foot buffer to 7,500 without infringing beyond a reasonable amount up into that building envelope? The literature we received indicated 100-foot. To a certain extent, that probably is a maximum. You've proposed some pretty good standards, I think. If they were incorporated in the deed to protect the 50-foot. My question is, how much do you feel comfortable? How much more do you feel comfortable pushing that up?
From a building envelope, initially we had a 25. We've increased it to 25 to 50 with the additional deed restrictions. We would, I think, as mentioned in the Conservation Commission letter, be willing to eliminate this odd little area of building envelope and incorporate that into the setback. That would increase it probably another 40 feet. I think once you start to increase that setback in a southerly or in a northerly direction, in a westerly direction, you're going to start taking away from
it. Yeah, again, I didn't see that.
Buildable areas. And I'd like to refer to Steve, if I could. Steve's the one that, from Woodlot Alternatives, certainly knows a lot more than I do.
Sure. Any comment that he might have?
My name is Steve Pelletier. I work with Woodlot Alternatives.
We did the actual delineation of the wetlands out there, and the vernal pool was picked up in the corner. It's vernal pools, I'm sure you're aware now, they've been listed as part of significant wildlife habitat and are protected under the Natural Resource Protection Act. They're struggling with definitions of what a vernal pool is, and the guidelines and standards that have been set up there, I think, would be appropriate in terms of the type of pool it is and the fact that the trees around there, if you were to windthrow or anything like this, you're still going to be within that 50-foot buffer around there. These types of pools are particularly important in the southern part of the state because of the types of species that they, the types of turtles in particular that they protect. That's not to say that they're not important here, but it's a relatively new, I can't say new, it's been the last maybe 5 or 6 years that they've received a lot of interest and they deserve it, but I think the type of buffer you have on there now will be adequate for this particular pool.
Okay. I guess what I might suggest is that John's suggestion, and I guess it comes from the Conservation Commission, to square that off to the east side, the east southeast side, to that buffer area. The buffer here, being an undisturbed area for salamanders, turtles, and so forth, and as a breeding area, to be undisturbed. I think that's a good compromise to be able to extend that to the south and east, if you would. John, do you know where the existing walking path that we hear discussed is located in relationship?
It is designated on the plan by this dashed line. It connects to Beach Bluff Terrace.
I guess I have to think about that a little bit more. Other questions, Roy? I'm sorry.
Yes, just a bit on that dry hydrant. As I recall, I think you need a pumper and a dry hydrant because you got quite some length to pump water. So if you block a 14-foot wide road with a pumper, you can't get anything in there. So I would like to know Fire Chief's reply to your dry hydrant idea as opposed to a water main coming through. Also, there was mention about sprinklers being used. The chief had requested sprinklers, and there's no response that I saw in your application to that question.
Right. I don't believe the chief is big on dry hydrants. He has, I believe, if we're going to go with a dry hydrant, has requested that the homes be sprinkled, and the applicant does not wish to do that, put that as a condition. I have checked with a number of professionals. They have basically all indicated that sprinkler systems in homes are very unusual and that they're a source of problems in terms of maintenance. And they are hooked to the well, which runs off the power. If the power goes off during a fire, then there's no sprinkler system. The applicant feels that the dry hydrant is an equitable solution to his request.
Are these homes that are there now, are they serviced by town water?
No, they're serviced by wells.
They're all well. And the plan is these new lots to be also serviced by wells.
Yes. It would seem to me that after discussing with these professionals that it would be more appropriate to look into possibly connecting these new homes with the fire department, with the smoke detectors directly linked to the fire department.
Thank you. Peter, you had a question.
Thank you. probably can't answer this this evening because the applicant's not actually here, but did you feel the applicant would be, would consider allowing town access through its greenbelt system for a foot trail through their property?
Yes, he has stated such.
Mm-hmm. And could one be detailed on a plan for us?
My, my discussions with the applicant, and he has, he wants more time to look into the implications, but preliminary discussions have indicated that he would be willing to pick up the existing trail at this point between lots 4 and 5, run it down the middle of the property line, and allow the pedestrian access to occur along Cantor Lane out to Ocean House Road. He has indicated that he would be in favor of that, however, he does not want to put, put anything in, finalize the negotiations until a later date. But he has expressed a willingness to do that.
Thank you.
So just so I'm clear on that, because I was trying to, the other alternative is to go to the south and then we walk through the vernal pool area. But what you seem to be indicating with a rough sweep of the pen there was to go along the north side of lot 5, perhaps up into the buffer area?
Well, between lot 4 and 5.
Between lot 4
and 5. The property line of lot 4 and 5. Well, the other alternative.
The other alternative would be to come down the property line between 1 and 5 and hook back. It appears, it's a little bit unclear to me, but then just re-hook with the existing pathway. I thought that there was another path that comes up near the Methodist parsonage as well, but I'm not sure of that. I guess my request would be to come back with, you know, a clear resolution of this footpath.
The other alternative would be to somehow negotiate down in this area north of the homes and connect onto Ocean House Road. He is not in favor of doing anything up along this property line here.
I just suggested because it appears to be where the footpath goes. He said I'm not familiar. I've never been on that footpath before, but it appears that it goes from the southwest corner of Lot 5. I sort of lose track of where that goes, but I think it's out toward the Cantor Lane itself.
Right. It goes off the property back on.
Yeah.
Along the top of Lot 1 and connects into Cantor Lane at this point.
But the applicant is not in favor of continuing that?
Correct.
Is that the path behind in the Methodist parking lot?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Other questions, comments from the board?
I guess, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Tom.
With respect to the vernal pool, I don't know how to say this without insulting someone, but I congratulate you for showing it on your plan. I think it's everyone's worst nightmare because it's so unpredictable in terms of the implications that it has on development, and it can be overstated or understated. Certainly the town of Falmouth, I believe, can attest to that, as can several consultants. The information that we have in front of us, which is provided by I believe the Maine Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife. The only reference that they make initially is in reference to a shade zone in a buffer of 100 to 200 feet. And in addition, they suggest the importance of observing the pool during springtime activities to determine the environmental sensitivity of it, and then based on those observations, make determinations with respect to the buffer. Did you have the opportunity to see this during springtime?
No.
Is there any indication that doing that would provide greater insight as to the value of the vernal pool, one way or the other?
In terms of the, in terms of this pool, one of the things you want to look for is how well is this associated with other water bodies and areas that turtles or salamanders might be breeding. If it's really an isolated area that's completely independent, it's something that kind of diminishes its value. In this area here, your more concern is bedrock outcrops. You maintain that cover over it, and in 1995 you might have great breeding success. In 1996, depending on snow cover and weather conditions, it may be a totally different thing. The point is it's an isolated basin and it holds water, and that it's not a consistent producer. You can go out there probably in late April, early May, and you'll probably find some wood frog eggs or some spotted salamander eggs. But I don't think that I'm not sure what you'll get out of that type of information. And then you also have, but what's important is to look at how that is placed within the landscape, too. There's value. One of the things that the IFW looks for in terms of keeping that 100-foot buffer, too, is because of the variability in terms of some of these pools, it's hard to know when to hit it at the peak time. So they err on the conservative side in case that pool can be possibly larger. I think we've picked it all up there.
Thank you. I think just for the everyone's entertainment this evening, I'll point out that the literature that we received identifies an incredibly rare species of turtle. And I'll quote, it says, by approaching vernal pools slowly and remaining concealed behind a screen of vegetation, the turtles can be seen frequently observed using binoculars. I've been in Maine a long time. I've never seen a turtle using binoculars, so that's... In any event.
You didn't approach slowly.
No, I didn't approach slowly, that's right.
I guess one comment that I had written on my notes was that the rephrasing of the restrictions around the vernal pool under the last bullet point that you have, it says subsurface wastewater, it's a real minor point, but it's subsurface disposal system shall be located down gradient of the vernal pool. I'd ask that so it's more clear that it's state that no subsurface wastewater disposal systems shall be located up gradient of the vernal pool. The reason is that we are not, at this point anyway, asking you to delineate the topography and anything less than 5 feet elevation there, and it lies in the same elevation level as you have for the approved or the proposed septic pit. Now, you've removed the one that was up gradient, and I appreciate that. The other one is just a case of being in the same elevation level within 5 feet plus or minus. And so when it comes time to place that, it'll have to be placed below down gradient from okay. The vernal pool itself.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Tom.
One more comment. There's a lot of discussion in here about site distances, and quite frankly, given the Planning Board always enters into this issue of public responsibility and safety, given the number of houses that are on this proposed within this development, I think site distances measured by the typical standards, and I'm certainly not a traffic engineer, but sort of local neighborhood knowledge and a posted sign of 10 miles an hour, 15 miles an hour, whatever. I mean, what we're talking about here really is sort of the camp road scale of development. And if the road access had to be located in some area that provided distance less than the 200 feet that's discussed and didn't require the clearing of vegetation, that wouldn't bother me. I don't know that you can always apply mathematical formulas. There's certainly a basis for sort of minimum public safety issues, but I'm not sure this is a clear example where everyone tends to know each other and they know the habits that people have driving in and out of their developments. So it's just a comment.
Other comments? Questions? Mark.
Perhaps one of the aspects that I'm kind of interested in is there seems to be a, now as you go further into the site, there is a wider and more stable road for fire vehicle access than we have at the entry to the site. What is the relative passability of the existing Canter Road compared to the new?
The Canter Lane, existing Canter Lane is 12 foot wide, 12 feet wide, with roughly 2 foot shoulders on either side. For a total of 16 feet. What we're proposing is a 14-foot wide paved road with 2-foot grass shoulders with gravel underneath for a total of 18 feet.
Normally, when you drive into a site like this, wouldn't you expect the road to get narrower the further you got into the site rather than getting wider?
Yes. Yes.
I drove it today, and it is a narrow road. Of course, it hasn't been plowed in the east, but one must go slow entering on Canter.
Tom.
Mr. Chairman, yes. And to the applicant, I apologize for this late comment, but in just going through the plan, I believe the public access waiver is requires access to a public street, and the first public road is Old Ocean House or Ocean House Road. The, just for consistency, at least the way I read the plans, the existing Canter Lane would be incorporated partly into Lot 1, and as part of this application, should that right-of-way or access be somehow noted to either get an easement through Lot 1 or reconfigure the right-of-way out near Ocean House Road?
Are you referring to...
I just noticed this, John. I've been focusing on the rest of the development, but right near Ocean House Road, it appears as though the existing right-of-way for Canter Lane goes right through, well, the road goes outside the right-of-way. In essence, what would happen is that Lot 1 either should have an easement or the right-of-way should be reconfigured to include the road, I would believe.
I had a discussion with the applicant about that, and I was also concerned. It appeared that the road meandered in a place where it maybe not was originally intended. He provided evidence that there is a mutual vehicle easement for all five lots across Canter Lane so that there are rights. Wherever Canter Lane lands, everyone has a right to travel on it.
Okay. Thank you.
Is that part of our right title and interest submission?
It's an indenture among the five different lot owners to cross each other's property for purposes of access.
Okay. I guess part of what we're dealing with here, John, and I know it frustrates you, it frustrates us as a planning board, is that we are looking, we keep referring to it as a development, and it's technically not as it comes before us here. We're looking at a public access waiver. There are issues that we need to be dealt with as planners, which there's some limitation. Actually, in the public access waiver, we have quite a bit of freedom as to what we look at under this. And I think what you're experiencing is some of the frustration we see, is and it's not certainly not the first time it has happened, is what looks like a subdivision is not a subdivision, but how we treat it as planners borders on that. And we're trying to deal with what we're allowed to do and what we feel obligated to do to protect the public interest. I don't sense that we're coming to any final decision tonight, and is that the consensus of the board, or does the board wish to take this to any vote?
Mr. Chairman, I'm the only one that I've heard speak out about the issue of the location of the road, and that would seem to me, at least from my standpoint, to be the major issue that's faced here, that what We have an existing subdivision that now requires a public access waiver, and the board's being asked to approve a road through a wetland in order to gain access to lots that are in upland locations, and that's a major stumbling block for me in this situation.
Well, what I'd like to do, because we have another application, another article on the agenda tonight, and it could be fairly lengthy. If we're not going to come to a vote,
tonight, then I want to send the applicant away with a strong direction, what he needs to respond to, so we can handle this in the next 30 days, next month's. Peter?
My concern would be not having on the plot plan public access to the existing foot drills.
Okay, I would ask that respond to the walking path issue, as however the applicant feels he can best accommodate a change in the walking path, whether it's by easement. Go ahead.
Is the board asking to document, have a easement drawn up at this point in time for public access?
I don't believe the board is asking for it. I'm just explaining to you that's one of my concerns.
And what I've stated to this point is it doesn't satisfy.
No, sir, it does not. Not for me.
Okay.
I think one remedy to that is to actually document some easement. I would be more in favor of that because it seems to be a concern. I think also just from looking at my notes, some response to the dry hydrant issue needs to be resolved. Is that the best resolution? I think the board feels more comfortable with something in writing, whether the chief favors those or not, at least some response from him, and we can make our decision how we want to deal with the dry hydrant. Like I said, we've dealt with them before. I guess we must have dealt with them under a different fire chief being in that position. But I think we would be interested in that response. Yes, Roy.
I have asked a question, too, on the page 3. There's the diagram of that pipeline going into the pond. And it says 49.8 plus or minus feet. Is that the distance from the dry hydrant to the pond? I mean, I don't...
No, the distance is 145 feet.
So what's water level 49.8 plus or minus mean?
49.8 is the elevation of the water.
I see. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I think something in writing from the fire chief. I mean, you're trying to utilize the dry hydrant system, and then he's the key person to gain approval or at least comment